transfer, didn't it?
Well, then you don't have to stay.
Have you noticed the atheist is never out tweeting?
Well, they've nothing to say.
No, because we've got common sense.
So what's your answer to the problem of death? So I've just met a lady, just a minute, I've left a minute here, but I hope she's not here. She said, I've been diagnosed with cancer.
Where do you take
just a minute.
Take
so I'm asking you a simple...
You take her to a church?
No, I'm wanting her to have hope. And Jesus, who's conquered the grave, said, if you put your trust in me, when it's your turn to step off planet Earth, you'll enter heaven too. Now, if you want to go into your grave, sir, because you think I'm totally off my planet, I wish you well. If you want to go into your grave, but at least you've met somebody today who's tried to enter your grave.
I'd rather put a smile on people's faces by smiling at people and spreading smiles around and go around.
How does a smiley face give anybody hope beyond the grave?
But now it's a bit irrelevant. It's not important anymore. What would you say to those people?
Well, first of all, that could be said by people who are petrified, who are lacking courage or even cowardice. So it gives them a nice cushion to sit on and not do this sort of work, which is tough. So I don't take that. Secondly, I could say that about many of the church services I've been in. So we don't ditch those, I've noticed. And just because it might be boring one day, it doesn't mean we write the entire thing off. If we did, we could write off loads of church services. But they seem to carry on week by week, so I don't have much trouble with that argument. The third thing is that we've got to make sure that we successfully get the gospel outside of four walls. And we're keeping it in. We're offering people life. I notice death doesn't stay in four walls, does it? People die in the street. People die in hospitals. People die all over the place. Well, if we've got the answer to death, we've got to be all over the place with them, haven't we? So to my mind, you know, let's not make any excuses. Let's get to the business of reaching people with the gospel of Christ. I'm praying about that, yeah?
You don't get to heaven. But we can't do that. Nobody can do that. Here's some good news, right? He only came for people who've done wrong. That's why he got on the
Well, first of all, I would say that when they speak and address people, first of all, I'm looking, are they giving me the impression that they think other people are important? The second thing is, does this man give me the impression, or whoever it is delivering, that they're speaking the greatest message on earth? And that is something they communicate with. So them are two big questions, which I ask. And the third thing is, do they know the difference? Because I think this is the biggest mistake, between delivering a dialogue and actually hooking people's interest and taking them along with you during their talk. And the acid
thing to eternity, maybe as an older man. Ladies and gentlemen, what I'm saying to you is this. If you come to Jesus Christ, he can forgive your past no matter what you've done. The one thing that we all regret that we'll never tell anybody else, listen to these words. The blood of Jesus, God's Son, will wash you from all sin.
One of them particularly was a gentleman called Lance Pibworth, who was the founder of United Beach Teams. And probably the most standout day in my training was he came to Liverpool in 1987, Easter time, to train a lot of young people, and I was there. And we were in the centre of Liverpool. We were outside Central Station. And Lance said to me, this afternoon, you present your talk to the public in the precinct there, then I will present it, and then you present it how I present it. Well, when I delivered my talk and I looked up, there was about 10 or 15 people standing about. And then when Lance took my talk and delivered it, there was about 50 people. And then he gave it to me and there was about 30 people. And I thought, well, this is amazing. Just by one lesson, he's taught me so much. And really, I said, what do you think the difference was? And he said, you must ask the crowd questions and then you'll involve them in your talk. And that was a great day of training for me. Because before that, I thought it was just a case of delivering. Well, it's not a case of delivering. It's a case of being effective and engaging with people.
I'll tell you why I'm doing it, madam. Do you want me to tell you? There's a little baby in that road over there where the zebra crossing is. What would you do to that baby if you saw it on its own on, in the road? Exactly. And I truly believe that you guys in this town centre are like that baby. And I'm warning you today that Jesus can rescue you and he can save you. But if you don't put your trust in him, then there's a place...
Some people get a crowd by giving out money, or they get a crowd by... telling loads of jokes, or but how do you then keep the crowds and keep them to get onto the serious things of the gospel?
Well, if you can involve two or three people from the crowd in the same conversation, it's a great skill. So if I do get somebody who interrupts me, I remember the word courtesy and I'll say, "Sir, thank you very much for your comment. Could I just take it again?" And let's say the man says something like, "Well, how do you know there's a God anyway?" I'll then say, "This gentleman has asked, how can I know there's a God? Now, my friend over here who's listening, do you think you might know the answer to that question?" So for a few minutes, I become a chairman. And then what I do, when I know I've got a crowd, I then remember that God's word is the sword of the spirit which the Lord uses, and the word which the Lord uses. And then I'd be able to say, "Ladies and gentlemen, can I ask you today, are you a real Christian? If you die today, are you sure of heaven?" And Jesus said, "You must have two birthdays. How many birthdays do you think I've got? You must have two. How many have you got? Have you got one? Have you got two?" And you're sort of asking them questions and then penetrating into the thinking. And I then round off usually by saying, if you want to know more about this Jesus who loves you, who died for you, who rose in the power of an endless life, then here's a Gospel of Luke, here's a Gospel of John. Take it and read it. Thank you for listening. Have a lovely day.
Anybody else want a little Gospel of John? I've come that you may have life. God bless you, madam. Have a lovely afternoon. Nice to see you.
And a lady called Greta Johnson gave me the most wonderful piece of quick wit Irish advice for preaching ever. She said, "Vincent, the Lord will greatly use you. Stay out of his way." So my first point would be get crucified. Then your reputation and yourself is not in the way.
The good news is this, okay? He died on that cross for your sins. On the third day, he rose from the dead. Pardon? Nobody else, exactly, and that's the evidence that he is God. For 500
people, you can know. And if you speak with conviction, it's a tremendous thing. There was once a famous actor, and he was asked the question by a preacher. He said, "You seem to get big crowds coming to listen to you acting and watching you do your plays. Why do you think I, as a minister of the gospel, can't get them?" And the speaker, the actor, said to him, "Well, over here, this end of the street, we speak fiction as though it's fact, and you speak fact as though it's fiction. And when the Holy Spirit gets hold of you and you realise that you're in God's universe, you've every right to share the gospel." And another thing is, the gospel is the power of God. The power is not in me. The power is in the commodity as we unleash the gospel.
To anybody who's willing to read it. Because if that's rubbish, when Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life, if you believe in me, though you die, you may live. If you want to stick with death, I wish you well." But there's some in the crowd who'll say, "No, I want eternal life." And Jesus has said, "I've come that you may have life. And if you'd like to find it, give it a read."
So question everything to get better. And then the other thing I'd say this, in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, "I am not ashamed of the gospel of God," said Paul, "because it is the power of God." Remember that you are not the power. And people, "Lord, give me this power," as though, you know, it makes them some supreme being. Just deliver the message, like Greta said to me, The Lord will use you. Stay out of his way. Deliver the message faithfully. Explain the cross work of Jesus. And let me just say this. I think the three dark hours of Calvary are what most preachers miss. You see, on Calvary, three men were to die. There was a thief to Jesus' right, another to his left. Now, all three of them went through a crucifixion. So what was it about the one in the middle that was different? Well, first of all, he was the Son of God. He is the Son of God. But secondly, from the sixth hour to the ninth hour, darkness fell across the face of this world. And in those moments, God laid upon Jesus Christ our sin. Now, he didn't do that in the darkness for the two thieves. He did that, putting that on his Son on the middle cross. And when people looked at that middle cross, they had to beat their breasts, the Bible says, and return the disgust of what they saw when God had dealt with Jesus Christ for our sin.